Thank you for joining Auto Network Reports. I'm your host, Roosevelt, and bring out your coffee and your donuts. This is our new time slot at 10 a.m. and look like we may have a full house. We're only missing one illustrious journalist, and that's Mr. Frank Washington. As always, please buckle up, don't drink and drive. Buckle up, don't text and drive. And as Frank says, buckle up, don't stream and drive. If you know an African-American that's 30 years or older, please make sure he visits his urologist and get that PSA exam. It's that little prick that could possibly save his life. But anyway, let's get right into what the show is all about, and it's car reviews and automotive news. Let's start out with the reviews first. Teia, what is it that you drove last week?
The 2023 Honda HRV. So I loved it. I drove it from here to Austin, which is about 3 hours, a little over 3 hours. It's smaller than I was expecting it to be, but it was great on gas. It was easy to drive, easy to park. And the more I drove it, the more I liked it. Something I thought was a little different was the placement of the nav screen was kind of a little bit off center, but aside from that, it was pretty much what I was expecting. I definitely like the way they've done something with the back doors that let them open all the way, which if you've ever tried to put a kid in a car seat in the back seat and have the door hit you in the butt on the way as you're trying to get, or have you do this twist and contortionist thing, they thoughtful stuff like that made it on point for me. I was like, okay, check.
Okay. Valerie, welcome.
Oh, I thought, am I muted? No, I'm not muted, right?
Nope.
I thought I was. okay, well, I have been carrying this around for a little bit, wanting to talk about the F-150 Lightning. I got a chance to drive that as a juror for Hispanic Motor Press Awards. And yeah, so very impressive. You know, EVs have just evolved so much, and I went to come up with a truck that doesn't use gas. That's pretty impressive, and some said was impossible, but I mean, this was a very impressive truck. I was impressed with how well it kept the charge. It's got a 240 mile range, and it really kept to that. Even, and this was the middle of summer, but it was still hot outside. And it didn't really lose the range very, you know, that quickly. It had all the bells and whistles, because the other thing that's really impressive about this truck is the price of $94,000. So it's just not for everyone. But for those who can, yeah, it's a good truck. But there was the other issue I found with it, however, was it's a truck. Most EVs I like to charge overnight. People say you could use a 240 for it to be a 240 outlet to do it more quickly, but I've always charged EVs in my garage overnight, no problem. Well, this is a truck, and it doesn't fit in my garage, and my garage door wouldn't close, and so I couldn't leave it overnight to charge. So that's something for people to consider. But yeah, I was just really excited to drive it. I mean, to be able to drive a truck and not buy gas, that's really exciting. But you know, it's still not for everyone. It's definitely an exclusive vehicle.
How about you, Greg?
I actually drove old school this week. I had a Toyota 4Runner TRD Pro. Now, this is a gasoline engine vehicle, 4-liter. It's the rock star of the Toyota fleet in terms of how long the platform's been around. In fact, that same engine and transmission has been around, my God, going back to the 80s. It got 16 miles to the gallon city, 19 highway with combined of 17 miles to the gallon. This was a four-wheel drive, a true four-wheel drive unit with a 5-speed automatic transmission, very rugged with a great skid plate so you could go anywhere. Fuel economy numbers are not that great, but this is the vehicle you want if you're in the wilds of Texas, or the hills of Pennsylvania, or trying to plow snow in Michigan. This is the one you want. The one saving grace that I really liked on it was that it had running boards, because even at my height at 5'8", getting in and out of it could be somewhat of a challenge. But it's also the one that you know that this car, this truck will start today. It will start tomorrow. It will start in 20 years. I have a neighbor who had a 20-year-old version of it, and he pulled up beside me, and he had a look of lust in his eye for the vehicle. Thank God.
He was like, 20 more years. Come on.
Right.
It's reliable. You set your watch by Toyota.
Yeah, it's difficult to find a used 4Runner. But anyway, Dawn.
Hey. Okay, so this week I'm driving the 2023 Volvo XC90 Recharge Plug-in Hybrid. I know that's a lot, but okay, so this vehicle, well, this luxury SUV is like gorgeous inside and out. I personally think it's like the ultimate mom vehicle. I don't have any children, but if I did, this would definitely be a contender. The cabin is really spacious and serene. And like every time I drove it, I felt like I was like being pampered. It has 3 rows. It seats 7. And the seats are made of like an all natural wood blend. And they are very comfortable. Like I drove it for miles. And I never, like my back never hurt. I was always like super comfortable. And it's like far as like the third row, like most third rows, they are not really equipped for like full size adults. I would say more small children. I did take it on like a little mini road trip, and I lowered the third row and I added my bags and like luggage for extra cargo space, and it worked out perfectly. As far as tech and safety, it comes with like all the bells and whistles. It has a premium sound system, which is perfect for someone like me, because I know like after a hard day, instead of me coming home and going directly into the house, I will sit in my vehicle for like 30 minutes to an hour and just listen to music. So any vehicle that I drive, it needs to have a premium sound system. Mm-hmm. And it has like a touchscreen, a massive panoramic roof, a crystal gear shifter that I love. Like, I think that's like one of my favorite features of the whole car. It's so pretty. And a foot activated lift gate. It handles really smooth. And like when it feels like it's gliding when I turn the corners, like I love that. And then as far as like the engine, 2.0-liter turbo engine. As far as like mileage, it gets like decent mileage with just the gas. It's like 27 miles. But when you combine electric and gas, you get 58 city and 55 highway. Like I've had that car and I have with the SUV and I have not had to put any gas in it. Like I love it. And as far as price, base price, $80,000. I know that's hefty. And price tested, $85,000. Now, like I said, I would love to have this vehicle if I was a mom. If you can actually afford it, it'll be worth it because you get everything. Like, it's so worth it. So, yeah, it's a nice vehicle. I love it.
Great. Hey.
Roosevelt.
How are you, sir? Good morning.
Good morning, Roosevelt. I'm well, thank you. I was trying mightily to get a Mercedes Metris this week, having heard Chris's review of last week. But frankly, I don't have the pull with the loan vendors that Chris has. So I was relegated to the Genesis G90, which is the largest of their sedans in a 3-sedan lineup. It follows the smallest, which is the G70, the midsize, which is the G80. This is called G90 because I think numerically it works. It also starts at $90,000. And when I'm 90 and I've surrendered the car keys to the kids or grandkids, this back seat at 90 with its retractable leg rest, with its massaging seats, and it will massage pretty much everything. In fact, following hitting the massage button, I had lust in my eyes for Greg's 4Runner. It was that good. But I would tell you, in sum, because I know everyone here needs a chance to speak, in sum, G90 delivers about as much as you'd like it to deliver for its $90,000 to $100,000 window sticker. It's beautifully proportioned. It's well-crafted. Mm-hmm. It's got the Hyundai, which is its parent company, 10-year powertrain warranty. And if someone is thinking German, but doesn't really want German 5 years down the road because of its repair costs or out of warranty expenses, I think Genesis hits the sweet spot in terms of luxury motoring at, to be sure, what's not necessarily an accessible price point, but will be accessible from a long-term maintenance standpoint. Anyway, I'd give it two thumbs up while admitting that I'd probably go for the G80 if I wanted a large sedan in the Genesis lineup, or I'd go for a Mercedes Metris, whereupon people could confuse me with Chris Lawrence.
When you do your review, folks, you don't have to rush. We're not bound by time and space here. So remember, this is the web. This is not the Weather Channel where Greg is rushing to right after this show. So,
well, then let me add that the review itself will be posted on Texas Garage. That's txgarage.com tomorrow. And that's 800 of the most well-chosen words I could find in order to give my full impression.
Thank you.
Love that.
Chris.
Well, I don't know how I'm going to follow somebody whose name is my name is Auto, but I will do my best.
And that's A-U-T-O, Chris.
A-U-T-O. All caps.
All caps, exactly.
If you're going to do it right.
So I had the 2022 Jeep Grand Cherokee Overland 4xE. And the Grand Cherokee was, like I like to say, was like one of the original fancy capable SUVs. And so this Overland version in 4xE trim is, they just keep elevating the luxury appointments in these vehicles. 4xE stands for, instead of 4x4, 4xE, that's Jeep's nomenclature for their plug-in hybrid Jeep. So it's still a 4x4, totally capable Jeep with all of the Jeep electronics and mechanical features and all that sort of thing. But it is also a plug-in hybrid, which is where the E comes from for electric or electricity or whatever. This vehicle was very comfortable. It actually had the optional air suspension. So it could actually add, oh my goodness, almost 12 inches of ground clearance to the vehicle. I mean, it's unbelievable. You know, if you're one of those guys or gals who likes to lift your Jeeps, well, you could lift your Jeep with the press of a button with this Grand Cherokee Overland. It was comfortable, quiet. The plug-in hybrid part, on electric power alone, you can get up to 25 miles of range, which is fine if you're doing short commutes, things like that. My problem is, out where I live, my commutes are typically a little bit longer than that on the daily. So even though Jeep was, they tout, I believe it was 57 miles per gallon MPGE, which is the gas and electric combined. I was averaging 33.3, which is still fantastic for a Grand Cherokee, but nowhere near the 57 because, you know, I'd burn through the battery on a single trip, and then I'm running on gas after that. The gas engine was a 2-liter four-cylinder turbocharged, totally fine, a little noisy when you actually had to use it without the battery. And something else that you want to keep in mind if you are purchasing one of those is that while this vehicle makes 375 horsepower and 470 pound-feet of torque, which is lovely, once you burn through the battery, you lose a lot of that power because that is total combined power between the gas engine and the electric motor. Once you deplete that battery, now you're just on four-cylinder power, and it could be a bit noticeable, you know? So that's something to take into consideration, is that while you do have great power with both powertrains working in tandem, once you do burn through that brief battery life, you do end up, you know, losing some of that power. If you can keep it under 25 miles, you can run gas-free, you know, the whole time, and it's wonderful. Kind of like what Valerie was saying, if you have a 240 outlet, you can charge it up, and typically, you know, within a few hours, you can have it fully charged again and you're ready to go for your next trip. As I mentioned in our last show, I do not, you know, I know Teia has one. I do not have a level 2 or 240 capability for charging. So that means that even with a vehicle like that, I still was charging somewhere like, once I fully depleted it, I still had to charge it like 9 hours, 11 hours, something crazy, you know? So you're still talking about a full overnight as well as a little bit extra depending upon, you know, when you get it plugged in again and when you need it for that next drive. The price of this vehicle was $75,305. So as with a number of the other vehicles that the panelists have talked about, it is not cheap, but it is a nice vehicle. And if you do some legitimate off-roading, legitimate, you know, you've got your cabin out in the mountains or, you know, down by the lake or whatever, and, you know, a bunch of unfinished roads and all that stuff to get to this destination, but you still want some nice luxurious features. And, you know, it's a good size. You don't necessarily want something that's humongous. You know, you're not really trying to do Land Cruiser or even LX 570 or LX 600 now sizes. You know, it's a much more manageable size, but you still get all the luxury appointments as well as the good fuel economy when you keep it under 25 miles per trip. So that is the Jeep Grand Cherokee Overland, and, you know, nice vehicle.
Great. I want to talk a little bit about what I was driving, well, what I drove last week. 2023 Toyota. This is the Tacoma, as you can see here. This is my complaint, trying to get my leg between the seat and the steering wheel, getting in that thing. This is the TRD Pro 4x4 double cab, 3.5 liter V6. 278 horsepower, 265 pound-feet of torque. I love the look of this truck. I love the badging, the TRD Pro badging all over the place. Love the bright orange color, or as they call it, what do they call it?
Is
it solar octane?
Solar octane, yeah.
Yeah, to me, it's a bright orange. Six-speed automatic transmission, 18 miles per gallon city, 22 highway, 20 combined. That interior color is black. $52,188 MSRP for this particular model.
It's a pretty truck.
I love the Tacoma. I call it a baby Tundra. It handles well. It has an extremely comfortable ride. You get the multiple driving modes, which I always like on any car, even though I rarely play around with them other than when I first get it, just to see what it feels like changing the modes. But it's a nice feature to have. What I didn't like, a couple of things I didn't like, as you saw in the intro of the video, getting in the truck, which I found interesting. I don't think I've gotten in another truck where I had such a hard time getting my leg between the steering wheel and the seat based on my regular seating position. And I always set the steering wheel and set the seats. But for some reason in this Tacoma, there wasn't a whole lot of room, and I don't have athletic thighs. So, you know, I have more like a twig for a leg. and like you Dave was, anyway, somebody was talking about the running board. This particular running board on the Tacoma, it's a 5-inch tube. To me, it's dangerous. It's a safety hazard because you don't really have a lot of room for your foot placement there. And you can step out of that thing. You almost, if you step out, you have to put your heel on it. If you're stepping in, you're putting the ball of your foot on it. And to me, you can easily slip. But anyway. Go ahead.
What was the window sticker?
52,188.
That's 52 with a 5 and a 2, Roosevelt?
Yes.
God.
52,000.
I mean, this is a mid-sized truck.
Right.
And I understand it's a hard-loaded mid-sized truck. But whatever happened to, and I also know you could get a Tacoma with less equipment for less money. But my God, 52 grand for a Tacoma?
That's the TRD package.
That's the TRD package.
The TRD. Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
You know, when you're putting five or 10 grand in shocks on it, it starts raising the price very quickly.
You look at the MSRP. I'm looking at the Monroney here. The TRD package is a part of standard equipment. The only optional equipment, and I mean actual equipment, is the tube step. And that's $589. You know, there's some state emissions and stuff like that, but the console safe, which I don't understand why they put that in there, but they did.
It's Texas.
Yeah, you know, $359 for that. But other than that, you get all that equipment in the Monroney, so you don't have any packages added onto it to raise the price.
One thing, you can always spot that vehicle in a parking lot.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
You know.
And that's
never lose it.
That's the new way of doing things is, you know, if you don't show it as a separate option, you know, on the base truck, then, you know, you don't realize how much extra you are paying for that TRD package.
Right.
This is just the TRD truck. This is just what it costs.
But if you're going to be taking that thing off road and navigating other things, that TRD package is.
Oh, yeah. It's fantastic.
It's fantastic for that. If you're going to be doing things like what you would do with a TRD package.
It's legit. That's why it's so expensive.
Don't be surprised if the vehicle takes on a new look next year.
Huh?
Don't be surprised if it takes on a new look or a new design within the next 3 years.
Oh, well, I bet so, yeah.
For 52 grand, I think you ought to get the full professional. It shouldn't be abbreviated as pro. It should be TRD.
like Auto, capital A, capital T.
The TRD professional.
That with 20% down, that is $800 a month over 60 months.
Yeah.
In a lot of zip codes throughout
the U.S. Tacoma.
That's rent. And here they are charging it for something that you'd assume would be parked in the apartment parking lot. Well, maybe not if you can't afford the rent for that apartment.
Now, Chris, that's coming from somebody who was driving something almost twice the price.
Exactly, right? I thought about that when he first mentioned the price.
Driving a Genesis, and he's complaining about $52,000.
And he made sure he said starts at 90 grand. Right. he didn't tell us what the MSRP was of it.
If you pay 50 grand for a Tacoma, the Toyota store is going to give you more of a massage than just your wrist. That's for sure.
But
mine was the only one less than 30,000. Actually, out of the ones we reviewed, I think the HRV was the only one under 30K. But it's something to think about.
This TRD Pro is
slowly jumping up. So you got to hope that they last
not slow at all
as I these mean, prices are.
Yep.
Let's get into. NACTOY. What is that? NACTOY.
Isn't it North American Auto Car?
North American Car and Truck of the Year. Yes, NACTOY.
Right. You almost got it right.
Truck of the Year award.
I need to drink the rest of my coffee to start thinking faster.
Greg gets the donut this morning. Right. Now I don't know if you all have driven all of these winners, but I haven't. The truck winner was the F-150 Lightning. Utility vehicle of the year was the Kia EV6, which I happen to get. I'll be getting this afternoon. The car of the year, which I haven't seen anywhere, not even on the road, is the Acura Integra.
Hello. Yeah.
Comments, guys.
It's a nice vehicle. We actually drove the manual, right? We did. Yeah, it was fun.
You're gonna have to pause.
I think they like the Integra. everybody got excited.
Yeah.
I would like to have one for it.
But anyway, let's have a little hand raising here, and we can take you. Go ahead, Valerie.
Teia and Don, were you at the Acura event earlier last year?
Yeah.
Okay. And I met you guys there. I agree. Definitely. And I had tried to get the Integra put on nominated for the Hispanic Motor Press. And now I regret that I didn't push harder for that. Because, I really enjoyed driving that. That was a fun car. All the models aren't the Acura models, but they had a manual, and that really was fun.
Yeah. And I love the inside. The interior was so pretty. Like, I love the interior. So gorgeous.
Also, it says luxury, but like without throwing it in your face. It just says, I'm a well-made car. I've got put together things like the stitching and the details and the way the sound system, speaker placement, you know, no hidden seatbelt things where you can. I mean, I think through mom limbs because I'm still strapping somebody in a car seat, but that's the whole thought process. And it's still fun. It's a fun drive. It didn't start being all, you know, stuffy. And, you know, you can tell where things got cut out to save money or not to save money. It was just a beautifully made car. I was like, all right, cool. I need to get dressed up for this. Okay. I'm not, but let me get there. That's what it felt like.
So what's the price point for that?
I think it's in the
price point on it, I think, was starting around 51, 52, but that's fully dressed. And, you know, Valerie and Teia and Don and I were all there at the same event, and we got a chance to drive in city streets. What I thought was interesting about it was in city traffic, you weren't fighting the transmission. It just did what it was supposed to do. Mm-hmm. I think Acura was smart to bring the vehicle, to bring that nameplate back. I almost wish they had done it 3 years earlier. Just remind those shiftless folks that, you know, it can be some fun to drive.
Teia, do you think it would have been as fun if we weren't together? Like, I think I might be a little biased, and it made the drive more fun.
I got it again for a loan right after we got back. Okay. So I had it here in Dallas, and I loved it even more then. It's fun on the drive, but when you get it home and you get to spend time with it,
it's a big and difference.
It's different. Sometimes you love it on the drive and then you get home with it and you're like, what was I on? You know, it's, you feel the roads, whether or not you can drive, and you're not feeling like you're on the bumpy road from hell. Oops, sorry.
Roosevelt, since my name is Auto, I'd like to comment on the auto category.
Go ahead.
Thank you. Yeah. Regrettably, I'm of the old school. And to give you an idea of how old I am, at one time I was 5'7" and didn't need running boards. Today I do. Next year I'll need a helper. But I am of the old school. And to my way of thinking, automotive car or car of the year, North American car of the year, should be given to an automobile that moves the needle. Moves the industry needle. And as nice as the Acura Integra is, and it moves the needle for Acura showrooms, so I get that, but it doesn't move the needle automotively in the way that a Car of the Year award should. The Car of the Year, were I on the jury, and I never have been, but if I were, it would have been the Kia EV6. Kia calls it an SUV, and that's wrong. And I think it's up to the North American jurors to edify or clarify to the Kia product team that what they've got there is a car fully deserving of the Car of the Year award. Of course, that then takes Kia out of the SUV category. And if I could take just one more second to look at my notes, I would have given the SUV category to the Cadillac Lyriq. Now, I haven't driven the Lyriq, but I'm sure jurors have. And to my way of thinking, that moves the needle in the SUV category. The EV6 moves the needle in the car category, and I'm completely happy with the F-150 Lightning, even though it wouldn't fit in my garage either. There we are. And again, my name is Auto, A-U-T-O. Thank you.
You picked all EVs for your move the needle. Did you pick it because of the new tech, or did you pick it for some other reason?
Well, it design-wise, technology-wise, I just think it's far more appropriate to a Car of the Year tag than Acura's Integra is. And again, not taking anything away from the Integra, but what we're determining here is a Car of the Year. And I just don't think a Civic-based, rebodied Civic, as nice as it is in 2022, 2023, whatever year we happen to be in, is gonna do what Car of the Year descriptive should imply.
Now, quick clarification.
You mentioned the Lyriq. Is that on sale yet?
I actually saw one on a car carrier when we were driving home from Tennessee this week.
Were you on the car carrier, Chris?
I was not, but I almost ran into it as I was looking at the car on the car carrier.
Is the lyric for sale? Is the lyric for sale now? Is it in showrooms or?
I know people are taking orders
now, and you have to wait 8 months to get one, but you can buy one.
You can buy it.
Yeah, see, I don't think if a car is not on sale, I don't think it should be in the. It should even be up for nomination.
I don't think it should be misspelled. Lyric is with a C.
No. they didn't want to pay royalties, but whatever.
I have a quick clarification before we continue with the direction we'd be going in. The Acura Integra was $37,395. Because again, it is still based on a Civic. And while it does look like it honestly could be a $50,000 car in today's day and time, you know, just to put more perspective into it, though, it is a sub $40,000 car and a nice one. That being said, so you guys, the EV6 was on the list. I never had a chance to personally drive the EV6, but I did have the Ioniq 5. And I loved the Ioniq 5. Now, the styling might be a little quirky for some people. I actually thought it was pretty cool in person. On paper, it was a little different. You know, it had kind of funky shapes to it. But in person, I actually really liked how it looked. You know, you got the right angles and all of that. And so I guess my question, because I know the EV6 has been getting a lot of hype lately in the media. Has anybody in the panel driven both? And what are some of the thoughts or differences that you guys notice between the two?
I'm just going to suggest that subjectively, the EV6, I find the sheet metal more organic, just something that appealed to me to a greater extent than the Hyundai does, even though I found the Ioniq 5 very, very attractive. I wished I had driven them closer to each other because there is differentiation on the dashboard. And it may very well be that I like the Ioniq's dash better than I like the Kia's. But generally speaking, the Kia looked like something that could have come from Jaguar with that sheet metal, a real setback proportion to it. And the Kia doesn't have, the Kia looks, to my way of thinking, like a blown up GTI. And nothing at all wrong with the GTI, but I don't want to blow one up. So
you mean the Hyundai looks like a blown up GTI?
The Ioniq looks like the GTI, right. But that's kind of it for me. Thank you.
The Hyundai, for me, the interior difference that felt different. The drives felt about the same to me. It felt about the same. I got one in the summer and one in the winter. So let's preface all that by the ease of use. It was very different. But the Kia feels sportier. It feels more luxurious on the inside. But the Hyundai, you can move stuff around. Like, you can move the center console. You can make it to where it's more versatile for space inside. So if you're going to be doing stuff with your car like that, I turned that sucker in the middle, flipped it open so that I could use it as a workstation. We plugged up a barbecue pit in the backyard to it because, you know, when you have it and it says it can do it, you try it out to see if it works, and it does.
I plugged the coffee maker in mine.
You see? Doing stuff with the vehicles that you wouldn't even think about, you know, years ago, you wouldn't have thought to do that. Nobody says, oh, I'm going to go plug my coffee maker up in my car because. I will say, though, that because the Genesis GV60 is on that same platform, I thought, wow, they took this one platform and put three vehicles on it and then tailored it to three different markets. And they said, I'm wondering if this is the way that it's going to evolve that, what is it, house? What do you call them? A design house? Not a design house, but a programming house. They're going to start putting the same platform and then putting three different vehicles on it, pitch them three different ways, and then skewing the price point by $15,000 on it as you move through the lines.
Well, Teia, not to bust your bubble, but manufacturers have been doing that for a long time. It's just, it shows up when they go the cheap route and then try to put it on an expensive vehicle. Right. that's the only problem. But like, yeah, the platform sharing, they've been doing that forever. you know, because that is the most cost effective way to get these products out there. Otherwise, they'll never make a profit on them.
And it's going to be easier with EVs.
Right.
Because you have that flat surface and they're going to be dropping all kinds of bodies on top of that. But I'm going to have to reach out to Acura. I haven't been in the Integra to see if I can get one out of press fleet.
Not everybody's raved about it.
Yeah, they've been. Everybody's been going crazy, thinking that that was the right pick for the car of the year. But I kind of agree with Dave. I don't think so.
Yeah, I don't know if I'd call it car of the year either. I liked it. I thought it was a very nice car, and I even thought that it was priced right also. But I don't know if I'd call it car of the year either. Just because there's so many nice cars that.
What would you have picked?
That was my question.
That's a tough one. That's a tough one. You know, because that's almost like saying, "Oh, Chris, if you could buy, what's your favorite car?" And I'm like, what category is it? Is it for luxury? Is it for sportiness? Is it
my pick would have been what Dave had, the G90. I think for a manufacturer to just come really into the marketplace in what 4 or 5 years ago. And come out of the box, they've been winning safety awards, they've been winning sales awards, they've been winning design awards. I mean, every time Genesis comes out with a new model, it just sets, to me, it sets a new standard in that particular model line. And I think the G90, for what you get in that car, like you were talking about, the lounging seat, rear seat, most of the time when I'm driving a car, I don't want anybody else to drive my car. When I got in the back seat of that car, I wanted a chauffeur. Wow. I didn't mind turning over the keys to somebody because you want to spend all the time in the back seat. I mean, everything was back there.
My challenge, I'm sorry.
No, you go ahead, Chris.
I was going to say my challenge with Genesis, because I love their vehicles. I think they're fantastic. Mm-hmm. And I haven't been in the G90 yet. So just, you know, preface that or what have you, because I mean, I've heard unbelievable stuff about that car. But my challenge is that while on paper, I love everything about the G90, I don't know if the brand itself is ready for that price still just yet. And let me explain. So when you're spending 90 grand on a car, you know, let's call it 100 grand. When you're spending six figures on a car, brand means a lot. A lot. It means that that's the only reason why people buy Mercedes, why people buy, you know, Rolls Royce or Ferrari or whatever. It's not because those cars are that many more times better than everything else that you could ever buy. You know, it's because of the branding that comes with it. You know, that panache, that little extra that nobody else, you know, has or what have you. And I feel like when you get to the G90, that's where it becomes a challenge, in my opinion, because now you're talking about, oh, well, if you're spending 90 for this, and if you can afford 90, then typically you can afford 100 also, or you can afford, you know, so it's like, so why wouldn't you get an S-Class then for, you know, 108 if you could afford 90 for the Genesis, you know? And mind you, this is just Chris talking, you know, but that's my thing. Now, when you're in that 60, 70, you know, even 80 price range, it's amazing because the competition there is totally different. You know, when you're comparing, you know, a mid-level 5 Series to a G80 that's maxed out, you know, like you can kind of give a little bit more. At least I feel like you can. But when you get to that six-figure level, I feel like there are other intangible things that play a big role in that, and it just makes it more difficult for me than to look at that specific vehicle, that specific level, then, you know, as far as, you know, with my own dollars. I just feel like when you get up there, things get more frivolous, you know. You can spend 45 grand right now and get everything you absolutely need or want in a car, but when you get up there, it's like, ugh. You know, so my take.
I would agree with you, Chris, other than the fact the Genesis brand doesn't have the longevity that you're talking about with the BMWs and the Mercedes. But Genesis has come out of the box, and from a quality standpoint, they exceeded Porsche, they exceeded BMW, and they exceeded Mercedes.
I agree.
That's tough to do in 4 or 5 years in the marketplace.
But we're talking as people where money is that much more valued than when you're spending six figures, you're getting what you want as opposed to what you need. You see what I'm saying? There's no reason to spend six figures on something that you need. You know, like again, 45 grand will get you everything you need. Everything. Heated seats, you know, stereo, everything you need. But when you get to, once you get to those levels, it's all about wants. You know, you've surpassed, and that's why there are so many crazy things that are put in those cars, because they've got to differentiate themselves now. You know, why would you spend 300 grand on a Bentley? Why? Yeah. Well, because it's got skins from calves that are from the Alps of whatever, you know, like that. That's the reasoning behind that stuff, you know. So that's and again, that's what luxury is, you know. That's the whole point of luxury, is that it's this extra, it's excess, it's not what you need, it's that extra that you want. And so, you know, I feel like that's still the challenge. And I'm not saying that Genesis won't get there, because Lexus was the exact same way in the 80s, where you're like, who the heck would pay that kind of money for a Toyota? Who's spending 50 grand on a Toyota? Now, 100 grand for an LS, nobody even thinks twice. You know, or for an LX, it's just normal. So I believe they're going to get there, and especially with the trajectory that they're going in right now. I'm just saying today, that's still one of the barriers that I think that they still have to cross.
No, I think it's that luxury disruptor space. I think they're speaking to a person who is tired of the legacy and wants to move next to whatever next is. I think those are the same people that initially bought into Tesla and spoke that brand language. But
I love that.
I can talk all day.
I love that, Teia. And I was going to add to what Chris suggested with regard to brand and branding and the brand experience. Part of that is what you get at the dealership, and Genesis falls way short in terms of what you get at the dealership. But while BMW and Mercedes-Benz are going to have the better waiting room experience with potentially free bagels and better coffee, they need the waiting room at BMW and Mercedes showrooms, Chris, whereas I don't think the Genesis customer will. So there's the good and the bad with regard to that branding discussion. And as I said in my initial review, I think in a 5-year ownership period, which would be kind of typical for that category, the Genesis is going to give you a higher degree of satisfaction than the BMW or Benz will, unless, of course, you've developed an affection for the service rider and want to see him or her more often.
Anyway, I want to thank all of you, especially the journalists, for taking the time out of their busy schedule, getting up early, joining us for a coffee. Next time we'll have the donuts. I'll make sure to get shipped out to everybody that's going to be on the show. But as always, please subscribe to the website or Facebook page of each one of the journalists. And like Dave was saying, you can get full reviews on the website of each one. We all cover the auto industry a little differently. As always, please buckle up, don't drink and drive. Buckle up, don't text and drive. And as Frank says, buckle up, don't stream and drive. See you next Wednesday. Bye, guys.
Take care.
Thank you. Bye, y'all.